Hey, how's it going? This is Nate here. I am at an orphanage called Shadow of His Wings under the James Project of Latin America. And I needed to make a video to inform an individual about the system here. So I thought I'd go ahead and make it applicable to both YouTube and to this individual. So I want to explain what we got going on here with the aquaponics and with the small fish hatchery that I've started. I'll talk to you about the system, how it works from the beginning to the end, some issues I've encountered, some things that are going on, some problems we've solved, and go from there.
So we'll start here with the fish tank, and we'll follow the aquaponic system through. In the fish tank here, we've got tilapia. Most of them are fingerling size. These are second generation from the original adult tilapia we put in here. Got a little fish food. Some things I have in the tank here, I've got some PVC pipe down in here. The main reason I put these pipes in here was for protection for the babies. I noticed that we were having babies and tilapia eat their own. They eat the babies, so the males do. And I wanted to provide some protection from the bigger fish for the little guys down in there. But the tilapia eat the food, then they poop, and the water drains through that PVC pipe down there. The water that is filled with nutrients, filled with fertilizer for the plants. Comes out this pipe here. Goes across, up, and into this 55-gallon barrel here. A positive, unexpected outcome here is that some babies come through these pipes and end up in this barrel, which has been nice because it'll grow algae on the sides, but the tilapia like to eat the algae, so they keep it cleaned up. So this height here regulates the height of the fish tank, because the fish tank fills this barrel from that pipe, runs across to there. So the fish tank will never get lower than this. Runs across into this barrel, and it's sprinkled out over the lava rock. It runs through this barrel, into the grow beds. Okay? So the initial design of this aquaponic system had 4 grow beds. This one, 2, 3, and 4. The water would flow into each bed. And you could regulate the flow with a valve to make sure each bed was getting the proper amount of flow. We found that without some sort of filtration, there is too much solids, too much fish poop going into the grow beds, and the fish poop was clogging the roots of the plants. So I installed some biofiltration with the lava rock to try to get it to catch the solids, allow the solids to break down, and clean water to enter the grow beds. I found that it's not quite enough. We had too many fish in the fish tank for a while. It was just too much for the system. Not enough plants, too many fish. So I've taken out a lot of fish and added the filtration, and I'm trying to get the system to balance with the right amount of fish, the right amount of plants. I don't think you can have too much biofiltration, okay? Biofiltration is allowing the solids to latch on to some sort of medium and the natural process of those solids breaking down. So the plan is for this bed is to raise it and fill it with lava rock and then put it on a bell siphon to drain into these two beds. So the fish tank will drain completely into this bed, fill it up, the bell siphon will drain it into these two beds. We'll talk about that far bed in just a sec. This is the height that the water will have to climb to get into the media bed. I set up a prototype bell siphon to make sure it worked, to make sure I get it figured out. So this bucket simulates the bed. This pipe will bring water from the fish tank into the media bed, fill up, and bell siphon out into these two grill beds, which will act as a sump. There's two main reasons for making this a media bed. Number one, a greater variety of plants. And this type of system, where your plants are on a raft, suspended over the water and the roots soaking the water, is called deep water culture. You can't grow a great variety of vegetables in here. Only lettuce-y type plants, celery type plants that use tons and tons of water. If you try to grow a tomato, for example, in this, it would just drown for the roots being submerged in the water. The second reason for making this a media bed is more filtration. If all that fish tank water pumps into the lava rock and then drains through the lava rock into these beds, it'll just provide cleaner water to go into the deep water culture beds. We have an air pump that provides oxygen into the water. Oxygen is needed for the health of the plants. You see how we've got this set up. We've got the main tube coming into this manifold, and then the manifold is split. One side goes to this grill bed, one side goes to this grill bed, and we've got it running through PVC pipe through the tube, through an air stone. The air stone basically breaks the bubbles up, creates more surface area of the oxygen. So here's a healthy looking Swiss chard that I feel like could be way healthier, judging by the roots. These roots are long and skinny. From my understanding, that could be two different things, and maybe a combination of both. Number one, not enough oxygen to the plant. Notice I'm not using net pots, I'm using styrofoam cups with holes drilled in it. Here in Guatemala, we don't have so many resources. I'm trying to get some net pots down here. But also, there may be too much phosphorus in the system, which phosphorus is for root development, and the roots may be developing too quickly and going too deep without going wide. An aquaponic system, you don't need the roots to go deep. You need the roots to go wide. They don't have to go chase any nutrients because all the nutrients right there in the water. Like I said, the pH is around 8, and I feel like right here you can see cabbage, and then right here is broccoli. You see how pale white they are in comparison to like the Swiss chard. I feel like it's because they can't absorb the nutrients properly because of the pH being so high. Why is the pH so high? Well, the natural tap water here has a pH of 7.6, so that could be part of it. But I think the main reason is because we've had too many fish in the system without enough plants for too long. And so we're trying to get that reversed. Got a lot less fish in there now, a lot smaller fish. And we're working on getting it filtered better. It's It's a balancing act. So the water fills the grill beds. It slowly runs down and exits out the end, which runs down back to the pump. We have two pumps. The one on the right is the one that we're using at the moment. The one on the left is a backup. I'm in the process of hooking up. The water runs from the grill beds to the pump, and the pump pushes the water down into a sump tank. Down beneath here, the PVC pipe is ran kind of like a radiator through the water. The sump is very large. All the concrete you see is the sump. And what this does is it cools the water, keeps it at ground temperature. Our sump is filled from rainwater running off the building down through this pipe into the sump here. The cool water is then pumped back to the fish tank. It comes out of these four nozzles here and is jetted down into the fish tank, and the jet motion creates a lot of oxygen for the fish. I'll go ahead and show you that. So the clean water is then returned back to the fish and it starts all over again. So an issue I was faced with was we have too many fish in the fish tank, too much poop, not enough plants. Because there's too much poop, I can't get plants to grow because it makes the pH so high. So I had to pull out some fish to get the poop levels lower so we could get some plants growing. The aquaponic system is for sustainability for the orphanage here. We wouldn't want to have to rely on outside sources to ensure the kids here get fed. So the fish are to feed the kids. I can't pull out 8-9 fish and feed 60 kids. So I hated to pull out these fish that were reproducing because I noticed we were having babies that were reproducing. So I wanted to pull them out, allow them to continue to reproduce and continue to make more babies so I can harvest the fish on a greater scale. So this is what I did. Turned one of the grill beds into a small fish farm. Looks like a mess right now, but there is a reason for everything that you see. What we got going on here is I've got four females and one male in this tank. Okay, this tank is separate from the aquaponic system. The water is separate, but with the turn of a valve, I can allow this water to flow right back into the aquaponic system. I'm hoping that once I get the media bed filled up for the aquaponic system and going, that I can tie this back into the aquaponic system and have water entering here, exiting out there, and that will help filter the water. Right now I've just got a ton of air stones, keeping the water oxygenated, keeping it moving is a big deal. And I take a hose every other day or so and run water in from this end. The water drains out down here on this end, and this is set to be this is my water level, right? So the water will never come above this because it just runs out. So I do water change. I keep the water moving. I keep oxygen in the water. And once in a while, I scoop out solids with the screen just to try to keep it clean. Not real worried about the algae, like the algae all over these pipes. Not real worried about it because tilapia eat the algae. I'm more worried about just the toxic things from the fish poop, from the fish pee, the ammonia, the nitrites. Someone had to build up and create a toxic environment for the fish. So let me explain what we got going on here. Normally, I wouldn't have the bed split in two sections with this piece of ply here. This piece of ply is dividing this bed into two different sections right now, okay? But because I've got some pregnant mamas, it's necessary. To set up my breeding colony, like I said, I got four females and one male, and I put them in this whole tank together, okay? On this end of the tank, I set up a flower pot and kind of faced it against the wall so it felt safe. And this is for the mamas to be able to lay their eggs in, okay? With the flower pot, you don't want it by any moving water because you don't want it to knock any eggs around that are in the flower pot. Over here, it's kind of hard to tell because it's got algae growing all over it, are PVC pipes. I've got five PVC pipes for the mamas to hide in. These PVC pipes allow the mama to hide in them after she's dropped her eggs in the flower pot. After she's dropped her eggs in the flower pot and hides, the daddy comes along, fertilizes the eggs, then she goes back to the fertilized eggs and picks them up in her mouth and holds them and incubates the eggs in her mouth. And see, that's the hard part about this, is knowing when the mama or mamas have eggs in their mouth. If your tilapia are in a glass tank where you can see them very well, you can watch and watch their mouth, and it'll get bigger. They won't eat, they'll kind of hide, they'll be defensive, and then that's a good indicator that they got eggs in their mouth. The other day I was cleaning the tank, and I saw one of the mamas, and I thought, man, her mouth looks big. So I got them all done into the corner with that plywood, divided the bed, and pulled them all to one edge, and I started checking the mouths. I pulled one fish out, checked the mouth, there's nothing in it. Put it on the other side to keep them separate. As I was trying to get the next fish, one of the mamas spewed eggs. I'm sorry. Well, yeah, they were eggs, but spewed little bitty fry out of her mouth. They had the egg on them still, but they were developed with head and eyes and a tail. Because of the stress trying to catch the mom, she shot the eggs out of her mouth earlier than she would have normally done. Normally she'd hold them until they're a little bit bigger. And so I had all these babies that were shot out of the mama's mouth. I didn't know what to do. So I tried to incubate them, which to incubate the eggs, you gotta have them moving, you gotta have oxygen, you can't have sunlight. And about 3/4 of the eggs or the babies died while I tried to incubate them. But we've still got about 1/4 left, and here they are. I've got them in this 5-gallon bucket in the bed so the water can stay the same temperature as the water in this bed. I've got an air line going in here to keep the water moving, to keep the water oxygenated. Let's pull it out and have a look at the babies that are still alive. After the mama spat out the eggs, I had to separate her from the rest of the fish because her babies can get eaten while she's hatching them. If she lets them out of her mouth, the other fish will eat them up, okay? So this is what I did to divide the mama up. Well, let me go back. In the meantime, I separated that one out. Two more mamas had eggs in her mouth. I pulled them out, checked them, she had eggs. So I had to separate those three mamas with eggs from the other mama and the other daddy without the eggs. So this is how I've done it. I've got three tanks. Well, the chicken wire so the fish don't jump out. I've got three tanks. This one, I pulled the air stone out so you can see what's going on. I've got this one, and this one, all with mamas inside. So within this tank, all this is a tote that's set inside the grill bed that I turned into the fish farm. On the side of the tote, I put a couple pipes that will allow water to come in and out. But you don't want the mama or the babies to get out, so I took pantyhose
and wrapped it around the pipe so not even the smallest little baby could fit through there, yet the water can permeate. Ideally, I would like the mamas to be in a tank that has its own filtration, has its own air, and that's more separate, but this is what I was able to throw together. Within this tank for the mama, you want them to have a pipe so they can go in there for protection. You can see her tail sticking out right there. She's hiding, feeling safe, that's good. And she's got all the babies in her mouth, okay? And then you got the air hose in there to keep the water oxygenated. Every day I take a little bit of this water out, put a little bit of this other water in, just to keep clean water. While I had all these babies, I did an experiment. I took out 20 babies and I put them in with the mama to see if the mama would take them back in her mouth. She did. That was the first day. She took those babies back in her mouth, and I assume they're still in there. I assume they're not eating because she's got other babies in her mouth. So the next day I put in some more because these guys were dying. And I put in some more, and she did not take them back in her mouth the following day. So this is day 3. I went ahead and pulled them back out of this tote, put them back in here, and they're still alive, and they're doing okay. So, ideally, I want the babies with the mamas, because the mama can take care of them better than anyone else. So from what I've read, you're supposed to do is you keep the mama separate from her babies until she starts letting the babies out of her mouth, until there's no more egg left on the baby fish, until they're developed that far along. Then I can separate the mama back out, put her back with the male, and then I've got the babies to take care of. The babies need fed 5 or 6 times a day, lots and lots of food, and I think an automatic fish feeder would be a good idea for that. So right now it's a waiting game. I know that my fry, that the babies that came out of the mouth already were about 9 days old by looking at pictures online. So I have an idea of how far along at least one mama is, and I'm just gonna be patient, watch and wait and check on them every day, see if there's any babies out of their mouth. After a while, if I don't see anything, pull the mama out, open her mouth, and see what happened. Maybe she swallowed them all. Hopefully not. So that's our setup here at the James Project of Latin America, Shadow of His Wings. It's a blessing to have such a great system. It's a blessing to have baby fish. It's a blessing to have lettuce to harvest and make sure the kids here stay fed, make sure they're getting their greens, and make sure they're getting the nutrients for their development. So, just praise God, just thank God for what He's doing here, and just thank you guys for watching. Be blessed. In Jesus' name.